Hello, and welcome to part one of a series of philosophy discussions or lectures. My name is Gabriel Wendt, and I have some things to say about philosophy. First off, to begin with the purpose and scope of this project, along with my expectations concerning how the project might be received. Philosophy is a discipline whose subjects tend to be broad and vast. Among other topics, philosophy is the study of the foundations of knowledge and the fundamental nature of reality. So, as a result, philosophy has put forward the task for itself of answering questions such as, what is reality? What is knowledge? And what are the scope and limits of knowledge? These questions are closely related to one another, and so it may turn out that by answering one of these questions, we may end up discovering the answers to all three of these questions. I do not mean to assume that there is, in fact, an answer to these questions, nor do I mean to assume that even if there were, in fact, an answer to these questions, that we could come to understand or have that answer ourselves. Nonetheless, I do believe that there is such a thing as reality, and I further believe that we can come to know its fundamental nature. In this series of lectures, I intend to prove that this knowledge is possible, and further I intend to demonstrate how this knowledge is possible. And then finally, I intend to prove an account or provide an account of the fundamental structure of reality. Broadly, it's my intention here to put forward an account of the foundations of knowledge, which in turn is meant to establish an account of the fundamental nature of reality. This is not a modest goal, I realize. There may be some people who would dismiss this project out of hand, even before considering my attempt, perhaps on the grounds that my goal is so bold. I believe that philosophy is not a discipline that is well suited to modesty. Instead, it is a discipline in which the most fundamental and abstract of goals are attempted, and perhaps even attained. So this series of lectures represents a part of my attempts to attain the goal of establishing a foundation for epistemology and metaphysics. I do not insist or expect that this series of lectures will be well received. In my particular society, like in many societies, there is little or no reward for philosophical effort, whether this effort is successful or not. Far from insisting on a positive reception for this work, I expect that this will not be well received, or received at all. More than likely, this document as an electronic file will stay at the bottom of a series of obscure YouTube videos with perhaps zero or fewer hits, and it has no way of competing with some of the more popular types of videos that are out there these days. Despite this sort of pessimism, I've nevertheless set down my account on the foundations of knowledge and reality on the off chance that this may be of interest to some viewers. So I'm also writing this at a time and a place which are unfortunate for the task at hand. I happen to be living in a culture which is highly unsympathetic towards the possibility, in principle, of discovering a final answer to epistemology and metaphysics. And there are historical and cultural reasons why people in the country where I live tend to be unsympathetic towards the investigation of fundamental foundations for metaphysics and epistemology. But even so, the cultural and historical details determining how this document will be received are pretty much irrelevant. That's because any given culture would receive this document, receive this file, and react to it on its own, in its own way. And so be it. You may also notice, if you happen to watch all of these videos, that I have very little to say about the role of God in metaphysics. So, for example, many people would find my arguments unconvincing and my conclusions unpalatable. I do have many things to say about the nature of fundamental reality and fundamental truth, objective truth about an objective reality. So some people from the 20th century, or perhaps the 21st century, well-versed in certain principles of postmodernism, might find my arguments, or especially my conclusions, unconvincing and perhaps even unethical. Well, bluntly, many people will find that my conclusions are going to be wrong. Disagreements between my various detractors do not establish that my conclusions are correct or incorrect. But I do have a hope that my arguments will be evaluated on the basis of principles that are universal and objective. And what those principles, those universal and objective principles are, I'm going to describe over the course of this series of discussions or lectures. So I'm going to make appeals to certain universal objective principles. I do believe in the existence or the reality of universal objective principles. However, I nevertheless also believe that every document, including this set of videos, has itself a context. And I also believe that this context makes a difference or is important when one is attempting to interpret that document or video. Now, the issue of whether or not context matters when interpreting a document or a video is of importance to epistemology. But this issue of whether or not context matters when interpreting a document is also of importance in a variety of other fields, including biblical scholarship, for example. When it comes to the issue of the context of a document or the context of a video, there are broadly two positions that one might take on this issue. It is simply a matter of fact that every document or video exists within a historical, linguistic, and cultural context. The issue is what, if any, effect this context might have on the meaning of the document. One position, called exegesis, is generally the approach that minimizes or eliminates the importance of historical, linguistic, or cultural context when attempting to discern the meaning of a particular passage. This has come up in biblical scholarship when people have attempted to discern the meaning of a particular passage of the Bible. Hermeneutics, by contrast to exegesis, treats the historical, linguistic, and cultural context of a given document or passage at hand as being an important part of the meaning or significance of that document. So, broadly, there are two broad positions. Exegesis, which believes that the context is not that relevant, and hermeneutics, which believes that the context is highly relevant. It's beyond the scope of my task at hand to debate the relative merits between hermeneutics and exegesis. Instead, for my purposes here, I'm simply going to accept that a hermeneutical approach is more effective, and then I'm going to continue on coming from that position. There are gaps in the argument that I'm putting forward, and I invite the audience to fill in those gaps, disprove various things that I put forward, or fill out the rest of the context of the position that I'm putting forward. Philosophy ends up becoming pretty much an endless process with people putting forward a position, which is by almost by necessity going to be somewhat incomplete, and then future people reacting to it and filling in gaps, falsifying the position that's put forward, and moving forward and advancing in the through the historical process of philosophy. So, there you have it. But I don't expect that my video lectures or my or the documents that are the basis of this, these video lectures, are going to be well received or received at all. So given that I'm pessimistic about this, you might wonder, well, why am I doing this at all? And honestly, I wonder about this myself. It might be of interest to people to speculate on my motives here, but my motives here are not going to be fundamentally relevant to the truth or falsity of the arguments that I'm putting forward. But I do have at least a few motives that I can identify for myself. First off, if people are curious about the final answer when it comes to epistemology and metaphysics, well, you're going to get it through this series of lectures. And second of all, I'm considerably concerned about relativism, and I'm going to put forward a refutation of relativism through this series of lectures. I particularly believe that relativism is an unfortunate blight on my culture, and it is not just one single philosophical position, but it's a group of related philosophical positions, all of which are incorrect, but they share some certain features. So by relativism, what I mean is various related positions that make claims such as the claim that truth is a function of the human mind. I believe that's incorrect. Or that truth is relative. I also believe that that is incorrect. Or that the fundamental nature of reality can be affected by the human will. Something I also believe is incorrect. But there are many, many variations on this sort of claim. And so I've by no means exhausted all of the different ways that relativism could be described or put forward. But there are two common features that are typical of all philosophical positions that advocate relativism. The two features are, number one, some version of the human will, either the human will individually or some collective human will, is capable of affecting or creating knowledge. And a second claim that is typical of various relativistic positions is that some version of the human will, either individually or collectively, is capable of affecting or even creating the fundamental nature or structure of reality. Now, the short version of this is that the human will, the claim is that the human will is capable of creating knowledge, or that the human will is capable of creating reality. There are many different ways to word these claims, but this is roughly the basis of what is being claimed in relativism. Both of these claims are false, but despite that, many versions of relativism seem to be rather popular in my particular culture at my particular time. It's not exclusive to this particular time, but it seems to be growing in popularity. So, in terms of another motive for me presenting this set of documents or presentations, I hope that this might mitigate some of the effects of the belief in relativism, and it might stem the tide, the rising tide in this belief. If I can convince some people that truth is objective, then this process will be worthwhile. And then, finally, I've got to admit that one of my objectives or motivations is vanity. It may come as a small surprise to you that self-published or self-created videos on the internet are developed and maintained through a process of self-promotion. And I'm not specifically trying to promote myself, but I am interested in the various ideas that I have about philosophy, and I'm, here I am promoting those on the internet. So in a sense, one aspect of these videos is, look at me, look at what I believe in, or investigate what I believe in, and investigate the reasons for my holding these beliefs. But I am going to end the first video at this point, and then I will attempt in the next video to lay out what I see to be the scope of the project as a whole, and then continue from there. Thank you very much.